All right, y'all turn to Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1. Back at it. Woo! I'm kind of glad, you know? I mean, like, I enjoy going back and doing a lot of the other type Bible study that we've been talking about the past few weeks, but Genesis study, I've kind of gotten into it. All right, so before we read, just a quick reminder. This study of Genesis is not a scientific study of Genesis. It is not a grammatical, historical, critical, I don't know all these words, you know, but it's... Yeah. It's not, it's definitely... Rin's like, no, it's terrible. I'm getting, she's not saying that. No, this is purely just looking at the record and trying to make sense of it this way. And so, that being said, I do understand it is going to conflict. Absolutely, it's going to conflict with all sorts of theories and all that kind of good stuff. And the reality is, we could do, after we finish just the creation account, we could start back over and address all of the theories and go about trying to talk about the pros and cons and all that. I'm just really not, to be honest with you, I'm not into that. I'm just not. If you're interested in that, I would encourage you. You know, there's plenty of resources out there from all different perspectives, and all of them will sell you on their idea. That's fine. I just don't think that's beneficial for my time to do that, and so that's why I'm just doing this a whole different way. So, that being said, let's start Genesis chapter 1. Let's start reading verse 24. We're going to read a chunk of passage or verses here, and then we'll come back and kind of dig in. Verse 24, "And God said, let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping thing, and beast of the earth after his kind. And it was so. And God made the beast of the earth after his kind, and cattle after their kind, and everything that creepeth upon the earth after his kind. And God saw that it was good. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them. And God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. And God said, behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed which is upon the face of all the earth. And every tree in the which is the fruit of the tree yielding seed, to you it shall be for meat. And to every beast of the earth, and to every fowl of the air, and to everything that creepeth upon the earth, wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for meat. And it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day." Okay. So obviously, we're going to get into the sixth day of creation here today. And so I want to, since it's been a few weeks, let me do this. Let me go back real quick and let's talk about the five that we have had so far. Okay? And on day one, okay, we got the creation of all matter. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, right? So we got all matter. Now, according to verse 2, what kind of shape was all that matter in? Well, it was without form. It was void. It was just chaotic. We also get the formation of light. Okay? Not the creation of the sun, moon, and stars. We don't get that till we get over into here. Okay? Or to day 4. But we do get light. Light, and just as a quick recap, remember this, light is independent of light-emitting bodies. Okay? To the scientific mind, that starts to put my wheels in motion because I sit there and go, okay, what does that mean? What do light-emitting bodies, so-called light-emitting bodies, actually do with light? You know. So anyway, we could go a lot of different routes here. That's day one, okay? Then we get day two, and in day two, heaven is formed. Okay, we get heaven. Remember, there's a firmament that separated the waters above from the waters below. So with the formation of heaven, we also get waters being sorted. Waters sorted. Okay? We talked about this as well. All this matter that was created back here on day one, apparently it was intermingled with water quite a bit. I guess water was sort of a unifying thing that sort of, you know, was a container, if you will. Okay? Then we come forward. So we have heaven formed. We've got the waters above being sorted out from the waters below. And then day three, earth is formed. Earth formed. Okay? Remember, all the waters were gathered together in one place and the dry land appeared, it said, okay? And then also on day three, we get plant life being formed. Now again, in each of these successive days, where's the stuff coming from that God uses to make all of these items? Well, from the very start, He creates all the matter, and it's there for Him at His disposal now to form and to shape all these various things as we get down through these days of creation. Then we get to day four. Day four. And we get the sun, moon, and stars now are formed. Okay? We talked about this idea of the evening and morning existed really before the sun, moon, and stars were set into place. But these were set into place for us to signify the changing, right? But it was already in place that there was an evening and a morning, okay? As that signifies a day. And then finally, we got day five. Day five. And what do we get on day five? We had the sea creatures formed and birds formed. So sea creatures. We're going to see in some passages today that was radically different than what we have even today. We also have birds or the fowl of the air. Okay. So that's day five. So there we go. That's all the territory that we've covered so far. And now here we are. Day six. This is really the day we've been waiting for, to be quite honest with you. We could really, honestly, Rita, we care about the other 5 days. Day six is the one we really want to know about, isn't it? You can, don't even lie, because I know when Rita thinks Genesis, she thinks day six of creation, because it's where all the fun is had, isn't it? And so that's what we're going to talk about today. All right, come back to verse 24. And God said, now again, look at this phrase, let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind. Now, we've talked about this before when we talked about sea creatures and the birds and all this stuff. That phrase, let the earth bring forth, does not support this evolutionary thought where, like, there's this weird soupy mix from which all of a sudden you get this little slimy creature that begins to evolve until eventually you get a highly developed human. Okay? This is not about the earth actually producing life forms. That's not what it's getting at here. The idea here is that the environment of the earth, if you will, that God has formed is conducive to sustaining and even causing these new creatures to multiply. So on day six, where it says, let the earth bring forth the living creature. What earth? Well, this one. The one He formed here, okay? That already is teeming with life and has everything needed to not only sustain life, but then to cause it to grow and to multiply. See, the reason why I sort of drew this out the way I did is this is much like a chain, but it's each builds upon the next. You know, if you had changed up the order, let's say you put sea creatures back here, it wouldn't work, would it? It couldn't have worked. And here's the reason why. I know it's a very simple reason. Because at the end of each of these, it says, and it was so. God, in His perfect knowledge, in His perfect wisdom, knew what was just so and what needed to be just so to support each successive day's creation. Okay? And so notice who is the most high maintenance, who has the highest needs of all of God's creation. Who's last? We are, right? We need a lot of stuff. And by the way, we get bored, don't we? We also get really hungry. So hopefully by the time day six comes around, we got plenty of food for us, right? And so nonetheless, that's what's going on. Okay, he says, and God said, let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping thing and beast of the earth after his kind. And it was so, and God made the beast of the earth after his kind and cattle after their kind and everything that creepeth upon the earth after his kind. And God saw that it was good. Now there's a few things that I want to draw out here about these two verses. Number one is that God made kinds. Okay? He made kinds. Now, here's my question. Is Chihuahua one of the kinds of animals that God formed on day six? Jen, what do you think? Everybody else seemed to already have an answer, was nodding their head and shaking their head and doing everything. And you just like, I'm going to wait and let Greg tell me. Okay. The answer is, it is highly unlikely that Chihuahuas were there with Adam and Eve. Okay. That would have been the first murder story. That would have been the first sin right there. Yep, 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 pow! Done. Okay, and then the first murder sin on the earth. Okay, Chihuahua is not a kind. Okay, Chihuahua is a species. Okay, so where did it come from? Where did Chihuahua come from? Okay, are y'all ready? This is going to sound very unchristian and untraditional in a lot of ways, but just understand what has happened. So God created kinds, these broad category things. We'll talk about categories here in a minute. But he created these kinds. Now, what has happened over time is that these kinds have multiplied. Okay? And through that multiplication, just like you see with humanity, you get variation, right? Then because of environmental factors and mixing and mingling from these multiplied forms between each other, guess what you get? Evolution. You like that, Caleb? Yeah, that's pretty much. Well, yeah. I agree with that to a degree. I'm not going to get too scientific. I don't believe there's been a loss of genetic code. I do believe there's sort of been a levering of genetic code. And what I mean by that is some become dominant, some become recessive. I don't think they get lost for eternity. I mean, the laws of physics, the law of preservation of matter tells us that they can't go anywhere. Right? I knew I could draw him out with some nerdy talk like that. See, Caleb, he's another one of my resident scientists. Jonathan and Caleb, y'all can talk each other's language. No, Emma, I'm not going to talk. I'm kidding. What you got? Oh, I'm sure you did.
Well, he was a closet Sunday school teacher.
Yeah, I'd rather be a closet science teacher. Yeah.
You could tell he didn't really agree with me. So,
yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. It's a real perversion, really. Yeah, I mean, to put a different word to it, what we see is mutation. Okay, we see mutation. And so that's what happens. So Chihuahua is a highly mutated form of a certain kind of animal. Okay? And so that's what it is, an evolved species of the kind dog. Okay, now, this is as scientific as I'm going to get, and y'all can argue with this, my resident scientist here. I'm not a scientist, so it is not necessarily my strong suit. The way scientific classification happens today. You start with what the broadest category, which is a kingdom. So animal kingdom, for example. Okay, so you have a kingdom. Then you have a phylum is the next level down. Okay, a phylum. So kingdom is animals. Within the animal kingdom, you can have various phylum or divisions. So for example, dog would be of the phylum vertebrate animals. It has a vertebrae. It has bones. Okay. An example of an animal, a creature that's a part of the animal kingdom that is not of the same phylum is, would be like a shark. Okay, they have cartilage, they don't have vertebrae. Okay, and so that's a different phylum. Then from phylum you come down to class. An example of a class is a mammal or mammalia. So a dog is part of the mammal class. It is warm-blooded, oxygen-breathing. Okay. I'm being very basic in my explanations here, because not because I'm trying to dumb it down for y'all. This is the only way I can understand. Then, once you get past class, then you have order. Okay? I got a question, Caleb. Is a dog a carnivore, an herbivore, or an omnivore? Omnivore, okay. So maybe that's the class. I'm going to just, for the sake of, you know, carnivores are meat eaters, herbivores are plant eaters, omnivores, omni means all, so they eat everything. That would certainly be the case in our dogs too. They eat Halloween candy here lately, and so they are certainly omnivores. Okay, then after order, you get family. Now, family in this particular case would be canine. The biblical word kind, as I understand it here, I believe it would be equivalent in the modern classification system as family. Okay? So the kind, canine, eventually, you know, whittles down. We get the mutations until finally we get this thing that is called a chihuahua, which is radically different than this other type known as a poodle. And then you've got, you know, Labrador Retriever. And then you've got Emma's hand. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. You know, that's actually a good point. Because disease happens as a result of mutation, right? You know, you can see this, and is it like a pug, I think? You know, they're really squishy and also have a lot of skin and stuff. I mean, they're a highly mutated form, and a lot of them die young because they can't breathe properly because of the way they've been bred and because of the mutations and the evolution, if you will, of these animals. And so there may not be a loss of DNA code. There's certainly a loss of brain matter. And so they get dumber, it seems, and maybe so does humanity. But so you've got family, canine. Then once you get past family, then you get to genus. Okay. Now, within the canine family, you can have big ones, you can have small ones, medium ones. Okay. In the case of Chihuahua, we would consider him of the genus small dogs. I'm oversimplifying this. Okay. So small dogs. We have small dogs. Ours are now. Ours are even more evolved than Chihuahua. We have what's called a Cavachou. That's a mutt. Okay, and it's just a mixture of different types. And then finally, you get at the very bottom, you get species. Okay, and species would be dogs. So that could be a Chihuahua dog, it could be a poodle dog, it could be a mutt, it could all these different things, you know, wolf, whatever the case may be. Okay, so kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. And that's kind of how they, so when God initially formed animal life, He did these kinds, okay? And there were many kinds. Now, here's my question. Are these pure, unmixed kinds in existence today? The reason why I bring this question up, you know, you get on the news a lot these days, you have these bones unearthed and people say, oh, there's caveman or there's Lucy or whatever, you know, the missing link. And I have my suspicions about that stuff anyway, but nonetheless, it's like, the way they explain their theories, I would expect to look out and still see these things in existence. But I don't. Okay? And so, is the pure kind canine still in existence today as God formed it back there? What do you think, Rita? Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's a good point. Hey, so I got a question for my scientist. This is mesmerizing me. Can you back up to a pure form? I mean, if the DNA is still there, the code is still in existence, could you back up to a pure form? Maybe in a lab? I don't know. Not impossible, though. You're an expert. That's interesting. Yeah. I'm just curious. So, basically speaking, the answer is no, these pure kinds are not still in existence today. However, I would say this, the remnants of their DNA do still exist. This is, you know, like the show Jurassic Park, it's sort of based on this idea. You know, you come across a bug that's preserved in some amber and you extract the blood out of the mosquito that's bitten the dinosaur. Now you have the dinosaur DNA and you can revive dinosaurs, kind of thing, you know. But let's think biblically, okay, and you know, talk about these remnants. Y'all go with me to Genesis chapter 6. This is so you guys understand that it wasn't long after creation we got the flood. And I say it wasn't long, relatively speaking. Okay, we got the flood. The flood was a catastrophic, worldwide, life-ending event, with the exception of the ark. Okay, look what happened. Genesis chapter 6, verse 7. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created. So see, that severely limited the amount of input into the human DNA mixing up, right? And he says, both man and beast and the creeping thing and the fowls of the air, for it repenteth me that I have made them. That word repenteth there, don't let it throw you off. It doesn't mean God regretted it. It means he had sorrow, because if you continue reading, that's exactly what the scriptures tell us. Okay. Come on down to verse 17. And behold, I do bring a flood of waters upon the earth to destroy all flesh, wherein is the breath of life from under heaven, and everything that is in the earth shall die. Okay, go to chapter 7, verse 3. Of fowls also of the air, by sevens, the male and the female, to keep seed alive upon the face of all the earth. Now, you know, if we go all the way back to the flood in Genesis 6 and 7, we do have the purest of the pure that we could have had at that time, or the closest kin to the pure kinds that God made in creation, right? We do know those survived through the flood because of scriptures like this. So the DNA still is out there, okay? It has just sort of diluted, maybe is the word. It has sort of spread thin through, you know, mutation and what have you. Go with me to Isaiah chapter 27. You know, it doesn't take a genius to go out and observe that we don't have the pure kind still in existence. Okay, even read a like wolf and coyote, because you can have so much variation even within just wolves. You know, you got gray wolves and you got white ones and you got black ones, and yeah. And so, but I do like what you brought up, and this is actually an interesting thought that I haven't really considered is, when man puts his hands on things, how much we can really, I mean, we can go from wolf to chihuahua. That is a real mess up there. And so, although the chihuahuas are fun to pet, they... That's yeah, that's right, a little toy chihuahua. They do. We tend to really mess up things. Isaiah 27, look at verse 1. Isaiah 27, verse 1. In that day the Lord with His sore and great and strong sword shall punish Leviathan, I don't know how you say it, the piercing serpent, even Leviathan, that crooked serpent, and he shall slay the dragon that is in the sea. Now, Bible students for ages would like to read into this and read into its symbolism. Okay? The problem with that is you don't get that interpretation here. Okay? But apparently there was a serpent known as Leviathan. I don't know what it looked like. Okay? I also don't know if it's extinct. I do know it was a created thing at some point. I would tend to believe that maybe the DNA from this creature is still in existence. You know, it's out there. Go with me to Job chapter 39. I was kind of hoping Cotton would be here today because he would have really enjoyed this, what we're about to read. Job chapter 39. Job chapter 39, come to verse 9. Sawyer, I want you to pay attention to this. Go to the very middle of your Bible, babe. Hey, Sawyer, look, babe. Do this. Take your Bible and break it in half. Go right down the middle. Okay, now back up until you see Job. It's right before Psalms. Y'all be patient with us. We're trying to get our kids to learn how to flip and turn and see this stuff for themselves. All right, Job chapter 39. Sorry, I want you to read this with me, verse 9. Okay. Now, there's a lot of times we read the Bible and it seems so like far out there and fancy and sort of fantasy like. And then there are times it is very fantasy like, but it's real. This is one of those scenarios. Job chapter 39, look at verse 9. Will the unicorn be willing to serve thee or abide by thy crib? Canst thou bind the unicorn with his band in the furrow, or will he harrow the valleys after thee? I mean, this is just a great trivia question. Are unicorns biblical? Are they real? Caleb? Put your hand down. You're not going to destroy my little daughter's dream of unicorns. They're real. Okay, go ahead. That's because y'all have got improper translations of the Bible. That's why. I mean, it's what happens when you don't read the Bible and you find some... Yeah. Yeah. King James says unicorn. Okay? It says unicorn. I'm going with unicorn. Could it be a rhinoceros? I don't know. It seems to me that they would have said rhinoceros. I don't know. Sawyer. Forget these people. Unicorns in the Bible. Okay? Just remember that. It's pretty cool. Now, I don't think they like blew like glitter out of their nostrils or anything like that. Okay? I don't think they're rainbow colored. All right? But it is kind of cool, right? When you think about unicorns being in the Bible, right? I do. I think that's kind of cool. And so, anyway. So, but there's something else we're discovering here. Where are the unicorns? Where's Leviathan? So, you know, we're going to see in other passages here in a little bit, there were other animals that we don't see anymore. Hey, you got to remember the impact of humanity on this world. Okay? And so, where are these animals? I looked this up this morning, actually. Since the Since the 1500s, if I remember correctly, since the 1500s, there have been over 900 species to have been put into extinction due to human effort. 900 species. Okay? There have been, since apparently the beginning of whatever people consider to be the beginning that calculate these things, there have been thousands of species go extinct. Like tens of thousands. Okay? And so, you know, if you think about, for example, elephants and their tusk in Africa, you know, there for a time there were poachers, man, and they were making big time money from the ivory. It's not far fetched for us to believe that if there were an abundance of unicorns at one point, and I'm just imagining they're the same as what you and I think of when we think of unicorn, that's a pretty special thing, you know. It may have been very valuable in other cultures and hunted for those, you know, those whatever you call it, the horns that they have on their head. So so anyway, that's how you kind of get around and understand that, listen, you know, things do go extinct, okay? Which begs another question, does that mean that portion of DNA then goes extinct? You know, so anyway, you got to get a lot of variation, mutation down through time. Third thing I want to call out here before we take a break here in a second. The Bible makes a distinction here, by the way, between cattle, between oxen, between beasts, and behemoths. It separates all of those terms. Okay, y'all go with me to Job. Since you're in Job, turn over to Job chapter 40. So I'm going to kind of come to your point a little bit, Caleb. Was it Caleb or Trevor? One of y'all that talked about, yeah, the rhinoceros versus unicorn, that reinterpretation of the word. There are those that read this passage we are about to read and assume that it means elephant. Okay? The problem I have with it is the description. It doesn't match elephant. Okay? So you'll see what I'm talking about. Job chapter 40, begin with me in verse 15. Behold now, behemoth. Now, do y'all know what the Hebrew word for behemoth is? Behemoth. It is literally behemoth. Okay? That's it. So it says, behold now, behemoth, which I made with thee. He eateth grass as an ox. I don't really know what elephants eat. Do they eat grass? Okay, we'll give them grass. All right. Lo now, his strength is in his loins, and his force is in the navel of his belly. I can go with that. Elephants, you know, they're strong creatures, right? Verse 17, he moveth his tail like a cedar. Have y'all seen elephants lately? You got that massive rump. And on the back, you got a little fly swatter. It ain't moving like cedars. If I think of a cedar tree moving, that's not an elephant's tail. Unless now we see such mutated things known as elephants now that their tails have shrunk. We got something going on here, right? Behemoth, I don't believe, is an elephant. He says, he moveth his tail like a cedar. The sinews of his stones are wrapped together. His bones are as strong pieces of brass. His bones are like bars of iron. He is the chief of the ways of God. He that made him can make his sword approach unto him. Listen, you know what I believe Job's talking about here? I believe he's talking about a form of dinosaurs. Now, I will be somewhat, or I'm going to give a nod to quote unquote science. You know, scientists or archaeologists, they go out there and they dig and they find big bones. And they find whole collections of bones. And when they put these things together, they look like behemoths. They look like dinosaurs. Now, is that an invention of man? No. That's an invention of God. Now, I all of a sudden I get a ton of questions coming through my head. Number one, where are they? Okay, we've already talked about There are tons of species that have gone extinct. I don't think you have to have a meteor crash into the earth. I don't think you have to have an ice age or a heat wave. Although, if they migrated down here in the southern portion of North America, you know, they probably died from heat. I can guarantee you. I mean, as big as they were, right? But, you know, if they were vicious animals, I can imagine humans didn't like them. You know, some of them apparently were docile and they were, you know, herbivores and ate plants and very calm. And probably, I'm thinking of Fred Flintstone, probably very helpful in building things. And so, I can imagine they were until, for whatever reason, they became extinct. It could have been for disease. It could have been a whole lot of issues. And I don't think that's very far-fetched. From a timing perspective, just know the book of Job actually predates the book of Genesis. Okay? This is, you know, this is a different topic for a different day, but, you know, this is why we can explain why we see, for example, Job doing these sacrifices and things like that, animal sacrifices in worship type ways. We also see that pick up in the early part of the book of Genesis. When you understand Job predates Genesis, you can see that this was a common practice, you know. So there's a lot of things going on there. But I believe dinosaurs, when Job's sitting here talking about these animals and the strength of the behemoth and all this stuff, they're dinosaurs. Now watch this. Go with me to Exodus chapter 22. Y'all, don't worry. Hey, this is all interesting stuff right here in this first session talking about all these animals. Y'all better hang in there to session two. After the break, because that's when we're really, that's when we're going to set up a boxing ring right here, and me and Rita, she's going to be in the blue corner, I'm going to be in the red corner, somebody's going to ding the bell, and bam! Right, Rita, are you ready? I'm totally kidding, Rita. You know, hey, I'm a wimp. I'm scared. You beat me up. I already know it. Exodus chapter 22. Watch what happens in verse 10. Exodus chapter 22, verse 10. If a man deliver unto his neighbor, okay, kids, an ass. I knew Seth would look up at me. Yeah, it's in the Bible. That means a donkey. Okay, it's not a cuss word. If a man deliver unto his neighbor an ass, or an ox, or a sheep, or any beast to keep, and it die, or be hurt, or driven away, no man seeing it, then he goes on. The reason why I read that verse to you is because, notice, it's making a separation between ox and beast. And then you, as you compare that with other portions of Scripture, you get a separation then too of cattle from ox, cattle from beast, and also separate from behemoth. Okay? That's why I don't think behemoth is like an elephant. I do believe it was like a dinosaur. But here's a question that remains for me. If Noah put two of every kind on the boat, what happened to these dinosaurs? Yeah, I don't know if y'all noticed this. I think this is the Thompson's wheelhouse too. They had this is floating y'all's boat. You like that pun? All right. You got a question, Caleb.
After the
mm-hmm. Hmm. Yeah. They also didn't have a place to land.
That's what happened to me.
That's where all the dinosaurs are now, the tortoises and everything else. Yeah, I mean, I do know this. Let's say, you know, Noah put two of the kind dinosaur. At that point, I don't know how evolved that kind had become. Okay? Partly because, Rita, I don't know exactly how much time transpired from day six of creation until we get to Noah putting the animals on the boat. And by the way, from the time God announced to Noah that he was going to send a flood to the time of the flood is 120 years. So, y'all think about what has happened in the last 120 years. A lot of things change. That includes in breeding. Yeah, 120 years ago, I don't think they had cavachews. They barely had King Charles Cavalier Spaniels and Shih Tzus. You know, so I'm sure they didn't have cavachews. So you think about how much changes. Read it. Okay. Mm-hmm. 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 That's a good thought. Yeah. They're goats. They're the goats of the early day. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's where we got the species bush hog. Yeah. And then the other one was weed eater, you know? And so, absolutely. Yeah. No, hey, you know, here's what I like about what you're saying. I don't know if it's true. I would assume maybe it probably has some truth to it. Here's what it does for me, though. It makes this more about real life and not just some fanciful tale told back in, you know, decades gone by, right? This was real life event, because so many times, like, we think about water gushed up and craters and on the moon and stuff, and that sounds so far out there. But I can imagine and really kind of get into the world where I see, we really need to do something about the kudzu around here, guys. What are we going to do? You know, you can eat it. You can make honey out of it, too. So, you know, like, so there's a lot of things. But, yeah, and here's the other thing we got to remember. You know, Adam and Eve and the early humans on Earth were not idiots. I mean, I can make a case that they were far superior in their knowledge and in their ability to think logically and critically than humans today, you know. But anyway, so it is the wonderful thing about the Genesis account, the creation account and everything, when you go back and you start thinking about those early days, it was a paradise on earth. I mean, it was so fantastic. It was perfect. Perfect in more ways than just everything was right in order. Perfect in just how exuberant it was, you know, and how exciting it was to the human mind even just to awaken creativity. You think about the colors and the size of things and the health of it, the vitality of it. So just really cool to think about. So, all right. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to take a break now. And when we come back, we're really going to get into some meat and potatoes. Okay. So y'all.